Good morning, students, and welcome to today's class. In the last class, we finished with word problems for multiplication and division. Right? So in today's class, what we'll do? We'll do a quick revision on what we have learned in the second chapter, that is basic operations on numbers. And in the next class, we'll be starting with the next chapter. Alright? So let's just see what we have learned in this chapter. So basic operations on numbers. So mathematics or arithmetic has four basic operations which are operated on numbers, that is addition, subtraction, multiplication and division. So what is addition? Addition is nothing but combining of two or more numbers together to find a total or a sum. Okay, then coming to in addition, the numbers that you are adding are called addends, and the final result that you get is called the sum. Same way in subtraction, subtraction is nothing but to take away. Okay, subtraction means to take away. So in subtraction, the larger number that is there, that is called the minuend, the smaller number is called the subtrahend, and the final result that you get is called the difference. Okay, so we have minuend, subtrahend and the difference. Then coming to multiplication, in multiplication is nothing but it is a form of repetitive addition. It is repetitive addition. So multiplication, we have the multiplicand, the number which you are multiplying, and multiplier, the number which you will multiply the multiplicand with, and the final answer that you get is called the product. Okay, so in dividend, then in division, division is nothing but it is a distribution of things equally among different number of things or people. So equal distribution is called division. Alright, so these are the four basic operations. In division we have the divisor, the dividend, the quotient and the remainder. Alright, quotient is your answer, remainder is what is left behind, divisor is what you're dividing with, and dividend is the what you're dividing. Okay, so this is four basic operations on numbers. So what did we study in this chapter? We saw how to do addition of large numbers. So to do addition of large numbers, what you do? First, you write the numbers vertically, one below the other, according to their place value. So we write the numbers vertically according to their place value. Then we add column wise. Okay, so we start with the ones first. Okay, and then you regroup wherever required and go on adding. So first we add the ones, then the tens, then hundreds, thousands, ten thousands, lakhs, 10 lakhs, up to whichever place is there in your numbers, that will you'll add till that, and wherever regrouping is required, you will regroup the number. Okay, so this is how you do addition of large numbers. So here's an example. So we have 6,04,757 plus 2,18,304 plus 3,75,526. Okay, so first here we'll write the numbers vertically in their place value. Then we'll add the ones. So in ones place we have 7 plus 4 plus 6. So first we'll add the ones place, 7 plus 4 plus 6. So 7 plus 4 is 11 and 11 plus 6 is 17. So we'll write 7 and we'll regroup here to tens place. Okay, so that is carrying over 1. So 1 plus 5 is 6, 6 plus 0 is 6, 6 plus 2 is 8. And then in hundreds place we have 7 plus 3 is 10, 10 plus 5 15. So we'll write 5 and carry over 1 to thousands place. So we have 1 plus 4 is 5. 8 plus 5, 13. 13 plus 5, 18. So we'll write 8 and carry over 1. So we have 1 plus 0, 1. Then 1 plus 1, 2. 1 plus 7, 9. And then in lakhs place, we have 6 plus 2, 8. And 8 plus 3, 11. So here the sum is 11,98,587. Okay, so we saw various examples on addition of large numbers also. So this was another example, right? So then subtraction of large numbers. Now how do you do subtraction of large numbers? So first what you do, write the numbers in their vertical form, in their place values, and then write the large number above the small number. You always write the large number first and then follow it up by the smaller number. So what is the large number called here? It is called the minuend, and the smaller number is called the subtrahend. Then we subtract the numbers. So here they have to subtract 4,25,390 from 6,04,538. So when I do that, I have 8 minus 0 as 8, then 3 minus 9. I cannot do 3 minus 9. So what I'll do, I'll borrow 1 from the next number. Here the next number is 5. So when I borrow 1 from 5, that 5 becomes 4 and 3 becomes 13. So 13 minus 9 is 4. And then 4 minus 3, which is 1. And again, I can't do 4 minus 5. We can't do 4 minus 5. So what we'll do, we'll borrow 1 from the next number. But the next number here is 0. So we can't borrow anything from 0. So what we'll do for the 0, we'll borrow from the next number, which is 6. So when I borrow 1 from 6, 6 becomes 5. And then 0 becomes 10. Then I again borrow 1 from that 10. So 10 becomes 9. And 4 becomes 14. So 14 minus 5 is 9, 9 minus 2 is 7, and 5 minus 4 is 1. So the difference here is 1,79,148. Okay, this is how you subtract large numbers. And then, so this is how we subtract large numbers. And then we saw what is multiplication. So what is multiplication? Multiplication defined as to calculate the result of repeated addition of two numbers. So multiplication is repeated addition of two numbers. So to do multiply two numbers, what do you do? First, here we have taken the example of 6,408 into 41. So first we'll multiply with the one. So 6,408 into 1, then 6,408 into 40. Then after you get both the answers, you add those answers. So here 6,408 into 1 is 6,408 only, and 6,408 into 40 you get 256,320. So now what we'll do, we'll add these two numbers. So when I add that, I will get 2,62,728. So the product of 6,408 and 41 is 2,62,728. Okay, then we saw how to do verification using digit sum method. So here we multiplied the numbers 349 by 526. So what you will do, first you will multiply 349 with 6, so you got 2,094. Then you will multiply 349 with 20, which you got 6,980, and then we'll multiply 3,449 with 500, because 5 is in hundreds place. Okay, so when you do that, we get 1,74,500. Now to get the final product, we add all these three numbers. So when you do that, we'll get 1,83,574. Now to verify if your answer is correct, we'll use a method called digit sum method. So here what we'll do, first we'll find the digit sum of the first number, that is 349. So when you do that, 3 plus 4 is 7, 7 plus 9 is how much? It is 16. Now to find a single digit answer, what you'll do, you'll do the digit sum of 16 also. So 1 plus 6 is 7. You can't add any more digits. So what we'll do now, we'll find the digit sum of 526. So 5 plus 2 is 7. 7 plus 6 is 13. Then we'll add the digits 1 and 3. 1 plus 3, 4. Okay, so digit sum of 349 is 7 and digit sum of 526 is 4. Now we'll find the product of the digit sums. So what are the digit sums? 7 and 4. And their product is 28. Now 28 will become 2 plus 8, 10. And 10 is 1 plus 0, 1. Okay, so that is 1. Product of the digit sum will be 1. Then digit sum of product. So the product that you have obtained by multiplying the two numbers, that is 1,83,574, You'll add all those digits. So 1 plus 8 plus 3 plus 5 plus 7 plus 4. So when you add all those digits, you get the total of 28. Then we'll add 2 and 8. So 2 plus 8 is 10 and 1 plus 0 is 1. Okay, so as a digit or sum of the product, now both product of digit sum and digit sum of product, both are equal, which is 1. So it means that your answer is verified. Okay, so this was division. So we solved the exercise of multiplication. Then we did division. So what is division? Now, just as subtraction is the reverse of addition, division is the reverse of multiplication. Okay, so to divide any number, what you do, first write down the multiplication table for that divisor. Okay, and then you can multiply. So first, what you do here, we have taken an example of 842 divided by 23. So to divide, first you'll write a few multiples of 23 down. Then what you can do is, you can see now 842. So you can take 84. Now 84, you see where it comes in 23 tables. So we don't have 84 and 23 tables. The nearest to 84 is 69 and 92. But we cannot take 92 because it's greater than 84. So we'll take 69. So that is 23 threes are 69. Okay, so 84 minus 69 is 15. Now 15 is smaller than 23. So we'll take down the next number, that is 2. So that becomes 152. Now the number nearest to 152 in 23 tables is 138, which is 23 6 128. So 152 minus 138, what when you do, you get 14. So here 14 is the remainder and 36 is the quotient. Okay, quotient is 36, remainder is 14. Now to find to verify if your division is right, there is a formula for that. So you will do dividend is equal to divisor into quotient plus remainder. So your dividend is the number you're dividing, divisor is the number you're dividing the dividend by, quotient is your result, and remainder is whatever is left behind after division. Okay, so to verify, you will do dividend is equal to divisor into quotient plus remainder. So first you will multiply divisor into quotient, then the answer that you get after multiplication, you'll add that to the remainder. Now, if the after doing all this, if your answer is same as the dividend, it means that your division is verified or your answer is verified. Okay, so this is division. Let me solve problems on division. Alright, so then we saw what are the properties of multiplication. So what are the properties of multiplication? When product of two given numbers remains the same even if the order is changed. So this is the first property. Second property, the product of three numbers is the same even if the numbers are multiplied in any order. So you can multiply three numbers in any order, the product remains the same. So the product of any given number and one is the number itself. Okay, so when the product of any number and one is in one itself, then product of any number and 0 is 0. So when you multiply any number by 0, the product will be 0 only. Okay, so then properties of division. Before that, when you multiply a number with an even number, your product will be even, and if you multiply two odd numbers, your product will be odd. Okay, so those are two extra properties of multiplication. And properties of division. If you divide a given number by itself, you get the quotient as 1. Okay, so if you give, and the next property is, if you give divide a number by 1, then the quotient will be the number itself. Okay, and then next property, every division fact has two multiplication facts. So one division fact will have two multiplication facts. Then when 0 is divided by any number, the quotient is always 0. So when 0 is the dividend and your divisor is any number, then the quotient will always remain 0. But your divisor cannot be 0. That is the last property. A number cannot be divided by 0. Okay, so these are a few properties of division. Then, shortcuts method. So, we saw shortcut methods also for multiplication. So, whenever you are multiplying any number by 10, 100 and 1000, what do? You keep the number as it is and then follow that number by the number of zeros in the multiplier. So, if the multiplier is 10, then the number of 0 will be 1, like that. Okay, so that is then multiplication by multiples of 10, 100 and 1000. So, if you're multiplying a number by 10, 100 and 1000, what you do first, you multiply the non-zero digits. Okay, after doing that, what you do? You place the number of zeros in the product. Okay, then division by 10, 100 and 1000. When a number is divided by 10, the last digit will be your remainder and the rest of the remaining digits will be the quotient. Same way, when you divide a number by 100, the last two digits of the number is the remainder and the rest of the digits are the quotient. And when you divide a number by 1000, the last three digits are the remainder and the remaining digits form the quotient. So these are few properties of division. And then in the last class, we did word problems. So I hope you'll have understood how to do word problems. So we saw various examples and also we saw the questions that are there in your textbook. So now let's see a few more extra questions, value-based questions, and then we can finish today's class. So before that, your previous homework, that was question number 6 in exercise 2.5. The answer for that is 6,000 students participating in an event were accommodated equally in 12 blocks. So how many were there in each block? So you had to do 6,000 divided by 12. So the answer here is 500. Okay, so there were 500 students in each block. So there were 12 blocks and in each block there were 500 students. Okay, so the answer is 500. Alright, now moving on to the integrate questions on page number 106. So there are 8 apartments in a housing block. The owner decides to jointly do some maintenance work for the building. So following are the projected expenses. So these are the expenses for the maintenance work. So for plumbing, 15,500, electrical 18,250, elevator 1,32,550, painting 12,000, gate repair 8,500, and rainwater harvesting is 13,200. Right? So they are asking a few questions based on these. So they have to calculate the total projected expenditure. Now to find total projected expenditure, what you'll do? We'll add all the expenses, that is plumbing, electrical, elevator, painting, gate repair and rainwater harvesting for to get the first answer. Okay, then second one. If an amount of 1000 rupees per apartment per month was being collected since the past 2 years, how much would it have amounted to? So they're telling that there are 8 apartments. In the beginning, they have told 8 apartments in a block. Okay. And then they're telling from every apartment they're taking 1000 rupees per month for 2 years. So they're asking how much it would have amounted to. So for 2 years, first you see how many months are there in 2 years. So that will be 24 months. So if they're taking 1000 rupees per apartment, so 8 apartments, so that will be 8000 rupees per month. Okay, so now if you multiply 8000 with 24, you will get the answer. So 8000 into 24 will be your answer. Okay, then question C. Find the difference between available funds and the project expense. Now, projected expense is nothing but the total that you have calculated in question A. And available funds is what you have calculated in question B. So to find the difference, what you have to do, you have to just subtract these two answers. Okay, so if all the apartment owners equally share the projected amount, how much extra would each one have to pay. So they're telling all the apartment owners equally share the project amount. Okay, so then they're asking how much extra they would have to pay. So now they've already paid for 2 years, that is 1,000 rupees per month for 2 years. Okay, so they have paid some amount for 2 years. Now you have to see how much they have to pay extra. Correct? So just do all these problems for homework. Alright, and in the next class we'll continue with the next topic, that is multiples and factors. So try to do higher order thinking skills also for your homework. Alright, I'll see you all in the next class, students. Thank you. We'll start with multiples and factors. Okay, thank you.